A very warm welcome to everyone in today's lecture video of different psychrometric processes. Okay, previously we have talked about basic psychrometry. That means we have discussed about some terms, that is dry bulb temperature, dew point temperature, wet bulb temperature, relative humidity and specific humidity. After understanding those terms, today we are in a position to understand different psychrometric processes. And let me tell you in the beginning that in today's course of lecture, we are going to understand these processes physically, okay, by giving some practical examples, okay. And believe me, if you understand all these processes physically, what's the real meaning of these processes, then you will be able to solve any kind of problem, okay, related to psychrometric processes, and it is very important. And today we are going to start with sensible cooling. Okay, let me just draw a rough psychrometric chart. So this is specific humidity. Specific humidity, you know, it is nothing but moisture content or amount of moisture present in a given sample of moist air. This is DBT, that is dry bulb temperature. Okay, now sensible cooling. Let me tell you that in sensible cooling operation, only temperature changes. Specific humidity does not change. Let me write here. Only there is change in temperature. Only there is change in temperature. Specific humidity does not change. Okay, does not changes. Now, so sensible cooling, we can understand that we need to perform some cooling operations. Now, how it is done? Let me show you. Suppose there is a cooling coil. Suppose there is a cooling coil. Okay, what is the meaning of cooling coil is that some refrigerant is passing through it. Suppose some liquid refrigerant is passing through it. Okay, now what happens is that suppose the air enters this cooling coil and the temperature of the air initially is TdB1. Okay, TdB1. Now, when it is exiting from this cooling coil, its temperature becomes TdB2. And of course, TdB1 is greater than TdB2 because it is cooling operation. But people may raise question in their mind that what has happened in between that the temperature has suddenly decreased, and that is the physical understanding. So let me tell you what has happened. Here is a refrigerant whose boiling point is very less. Okay, so let its temperature TdB1 be 30 degrees Celsius. Let its temperature be 30 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now, suppose there is a refrigerant whose boiling point is 15 degrees Celsius. Just an example, this refrigerant whose boiling point is 15 degrees Celsius. Now, when this moist air is going to pass through this cooling coil, then what will happen? This refrigerant that is flowing through this coil is going to absorb heat from this air. This refrigerant is going to absorb heat from this air and it is going to vaporize. So when it is taking the heat from this air, so the air that is exiting from this cooling coil is of course cooled down. Okay, it has cooled down. Okay, now this process that is taking place here, only the temperature has changed. Okay, there is no change in humidity, that is the moisture content. Okay, what I mean to say is that the amount of the moisture that is present in the air when it has entered here is also the is same when it is exiting. Okay, now you have understood that how this sensible cooling operation has taken place. Now can you tell me one thing, that when air is going to exit from this cooling coil, what should be its temperature? Can you tell? You may not be able to tell the exact temperature, but you can guess that the whatever be the temperature, it should be less than 30 degrees Celsius and more than 15 degrees Celsius. When it is exiting from here, it should have been 15 degrees Celsius in ideal case. But in reality, it is not 15 degrees Celsius. It is something more than that. Let it be 20 degrees Celsius. Okay. And with this concept only, I am going to explain you what is bypass factor. Then we will plot that graph in this psychrometric chart. Okay. But let me explain you what is bypass factor first. Okay, let me write, this was TdB1 and at the exit it is TdB2. Let the temperature of this cooling coil is TdB3. Okay, this cooling coil temperature is suppose TdB3. Okay. Now let's understand what is bypass factor. This is the formula of bypass factor. But if I write the formula, what you have understood is zero, nothing. So I have to explain it. Okay, see, when air is passing through this coil, do you expect that all the air is touching this coil surface? Some air has passed through this middle portions also. Try to understand. This is your coiling. This was your coiling. And suppose air has passed through this. Suppose air has passed. Now the air, when air is passing, only some maximum part is touching this coil, but some part is also passing through this portion. Okay. So some part is not affected by this coil. Okay. So we have to consider that. Okay. And that's why here the temperature TdB3 and TdB2 were not same. If all the moist air that has passed gets affected by this cooling coil, okay, if all the moist air has touched the surface of the cooling coil, then of course this when at the exit it would have taken the temperature of the cooling coil, that is 15 degrees Celsius, but it has not taken. That's why the formula is this, that is, in the denominator it is inlet temperature minus the cooling coil temperature, and in the numerator it has got the temperature at the exit minus the cooling coil temperature. Now in ideal case, what I have told you is that TdB2 and TdB3 would have been same. That means in ideal case bypass factor is zero. But in reality, there is always some amount of bypass factor present. Okay. So, let me write here. In ideal case, bypass factor is zero. In ideal case, bypass factor is zero. Because when the air is exiting, its temperature is same as that of the temperature of the cooling coil. Okay. Now let's see how to plot this in this psychrometric chart. Initially my temperature is TdB1, okay, inlet temperature. Now I have cooled it to TdB3. This is TdB3, that is the temperature of the cooling coil. That means this was my initial condition, but I have taken the moist air up to this temperature. But what is the final temperature attained by the moist air? It is something more than TdB3. That means here. Okay, so this is state point 1, this is state point 3, and this is state point 2. Okay, this is your TdB2. This is TdB2. Okay, you have understood. So the operation has taken place in this direction. You were present at 1, you have taken it up to 3, but due to some bypass factor, you have not get the temperature you wanted. That is the temperature of the cooling coil. You have got temperature something more than that. Okay, this is sensible cooling operation. So how much heat is removed from the system? How much heat is removed? Q, it is nothing but enthalpy. Enthalpy difference. So enthalpy, you know, in psychrometry chart, these are the values of enthalpy. So you will draw one straight line from here. So this is H1, this is H1, and this is H2. So if someone asks you what is the net cooling effect or how much heat is removed, that is nothing but H1 minus H2. Okay, not H3, because ultimately at last you have reached to this temperature. So how much heat you have removed is this minus this. Okay, not this, because your final temperature is this thing. Okay, now I think you have understood about sensible cooling. Now let me tell you about one more thing about sensible cooling, very interesting. We have written here that in sensible cooling only the specific humidity does not change, a specific humidity does not change us. But can you tell me one answer that whether relative humidity will change or not? Whether relative humidity will change or not? Let's see it. Let's find out the answer. So relative humidity, it is what? It is nothing but PV by PS, or you can write it also MV by MS. That is the mass of water vapor that is present in the air in the current situation. Okay, in a particular temperature or in a current temperature, that how much mass of water vapor is present in the air. And this is MS, is that in that same temperature, what is the maximum amount of water vapor air can hold? Okay, what is the maximum amount of water vapor? Now what we have done is that we have went on going decreasing the temperature. Okay, now MV, this value is constant because we have not removed any moisture from the air. But MS has automatically changed, because it is the property of air that if you decrease the temperature of the air, it is not going to hold the same amount of moisture. Okay, the maximum amount of moisture that air can hold will decrease as you go on decreasing the temperature. So this value will go on decreasing. Okay, this value will go on decreasing. So ultimately the value of relative humidity will increase, because if the denominator decreases, this value will increase. So with the cooling process, relative humidity has increased. But what is the amount of moisture that is present in the air, that is the specific humidity, has not changed. Okay, this is the understanding of sensible cooling process. Now we will study about sensible heating process. See, once you have understood about sensible cooling by spending so much of time, now you will understand sensible heating in just very few minutes. Okay. Before moving into sensible heating, let me ask you one more very interesting question. This question will help you to clear your knowledge, to clear your doubt, okay? To clear your doubt, okay? So that you don't have any problem when you solve problems, numerical problems. Okay, so my question is that, initially you are at this temperature. Now you are going on cooling it. Up to how much? Up to which temperature you may cool? This is my question. Do you understand my question? Initially we are at this temperature, TdB1. Suppose this is 30 degrees Celsius. Suppose, just an example. Now my question is that, up to how much temperature you can cool without changing humidity? That means, up to how much temperature you can do this sensible cooling operation. Okay, this is my question. So what will be the answer? Answer is very simple. Up to dew point temperature, or DPT. Because dew point temperature is the saturation temperature. If you go below the dew point temperature, then condensation will take place. When you are reaching dew point temperature, relative humidity is becoming 100%, MV and MS are becoming same, or you can say that the partial pressure, PV and the PS, saturated partial pressure, are becoming same. Okay. So again, if you just decrease after reaching dew point temperature, slightly decrease the temperature, condensation will take place. And condensation take place means you are changing the humidity, but sensible cooling process does not allows that. Okay, so if anybody asks you that up to how much temperature you can do the sensible cooling process, answer will be up to the dew point temperature. You can see from this chart also, you were initially at this position. Up to how much you can cool, up to this point, that is the dew point temperature, up to this point, that is the dew point temperature. Okay, if you cool below this, if you cool below this, then what will happen? I have told you, then condensation will take place. Condensation means dehumidification. Humidity is decreasing, but that is not allowed. I cannot change the humidity. I cannot change the specific humidity. Okay. Can you understand? Okay. Now we are ready to move into sensible heating operation. Once you have understood sensible cooling operation, it is very easy to understand sensible heating. Okay. And if you have any doubt regarding this lecture, you please comment in the comment box. I will try to help you out as much as possible. So what is sensible heating? Sensible heating is nothing just but the reverse of sensible cooling. Suppose there is a coil which is heated electrically. Suppose it is electrically heated, and the temperature of the coil is, suppose, 30 degrees Celsius. Just an example. And I am passing this moist air which I want to heat, without changing any humidity. This is, again, I am alarming you, that without changing any humidity, that is sensible heating. Suppose the temperature initially is 20 degrees Celsius. So it is from our common sense only. If we want to heat it, then the temperature of the heating coil must be more than this. This is from our common sense we can tell. Then again from our common sense we can say that the air that is leaving this heating coil is not going to be heated up to 30 degrees Celsius. It will be heated to somewhat less, 25 degrees Celsius. Okay, because of the bypass factor again. So if I ask you to write the formula for bypass factor in this case, you will be able to write it in your own. So the formula for bypass factor in this case will be this. Let's check out. Suppose first name it. Suppose this is TdB2. Okay. This is TdB1 initial condition. That's why 1. This is TdB3. Okay. So in the denominator same thing. TdB3 minus TdB1. As we have seen in the case of sensible cooling. But in the numerator, now the B2 is less than B3. Okay. So it will be TdB3 minus TdB2. Again, let's check out that what I have told that in ideal case, when air is moist air is passing through this coil, then it will attain the same temperature as that of the heating coil. That means these two will be same. When these two are same, then bypass factor is 0. Okay. So again, right, in ideal case, bypass factor is 0. Okay. You have understood this thing. Now let's check out how it will be visible in the psychrometric chart, this process. So initially you are at a temperature TD. This process is heating process, okay. So initial process temperature was something here, TdB1. So this is TdB1, your initial condition. You want it to be heated up to this much, TdB3. That means initially your temperature is 20 degrees Celsius. You want to heat it to 30 degrees Celsius. So your process has undergone this much. But due to some bypass factor, you have reached ultimately in this portion, TdB2. That is something about 25 degrees Celsius. This is just an example. Again, that how much heat is added to the system is the sensible heat only. Okay, there is no latent heat. So this was your enthalpy line. Heat is nothing but enthalpy. So what is the heat added is the difference in enthalpy. So these are my three enthalpy zones. But what is my heating effect is it is H2 minus H1, because final position is this position. I have tried to heat it up to this, but I didn't get that temperature in finally. What I have got is this. So this is my final H2 enthalpy at this position, H2, and this is H1 initial condition. Okay, this is H3. So what is the heat added? It is H2 minus H1. Okay, so this was about sensible heating. Again, if I ask you one question, that up to in your initial temperature is 20 degrees Celsius, but up to how much temperature you can heat it? Okay, if I ask you this question, then what will be its answer? Its answer is very simple, that you can heat it up to as much as you want. There is no limit. Okay, there is no limit in this case, because if you heat it, go on heating it, the temperature will go on increasing. Okay, but you cannot cool down below dew point temperature. Okay, you can cool down, but if you want only cooling without changing in humidity, then you are not allowed to go below dew point temperature. Okay, that you have understood. That means if you want only sensible cooling, then you cannot go below dew point temperature. Okay, now I can guarantee you that if you watch this lecture, you will easily understand the remaining psychrometric processes. Okay, that I will discuss in another lecture, because if I just discuss those lectures, those topics in this video only, this video is going to become very long. Okay, so I will discuss the remaining topics in my next lecture. Whatever doubts you have got, you please feel free to comment in the comment box. Thank you very much.